I'm throwing horseshoes over my left shoulder. I've spent most all my life searching for that four-leaf clover. Yet you run with me, chasing my rainbow. Honey, I love you too. That's the way love goes. That's the way love goes, babe. That's the music for the whole wide world to sing. It never gets old, it only grows. Losing makes me sorry. You say, don't you worry. Honey, I love you too. That's the way love goes. That's the way love goes, babe. That's the music I made for the whole wide world to sing. Never gets old, it only grows. And losing makes me sorry. You say, don't you worry. And that's the way love goes.
All right, let's talk about occupational radiation. And before I get started with this first video in the unit, let me talk a little bit about occupational radiation and the importance of studying occupational radiation for safety professionals. I think it's necessary for safety professionals, all safety professionals, if you're at that professional level, to have some background studying ionizing radiation and non-ionizing radiation for that matter. To know a little bit about the basic principles, exposure limits, those types of things. But as you'll see once I get into it, occupational radiation exposure is very rare. We're only going to encounter occupational radiation in some very specialized fields. It's not, if you end up working in construction as a safety manager, you're not going to have to deal with your workers being exposed to ionizing radiation, except for background radiation. We're all exposed to ionizing radiation. There's background radiation around us at all times, and I'll talk a little bit about that as we go along. But as far as being exposed to high doses of ionizing radiation, there are only a few industries, a few sectors of the economy where it's going to be an issue. Chapter 10 is the textbook chapter that deals with ionizing radiation. Chapter 11 deals with non-ionizing radiation. I'm going to spend most of our time in this unit talking about ionizing radiation, just a little tidbit on non-ionizing radiation. Originally, I thought, well, I'll have you read chapter 10 and do a study guide, but that is such a monstrous chapter. There's so much information in there. And a lot of it is very science-oriented, if you will, which you guys certainly could handle that. You could do that. You could study that, and you know, get all the details. You're capable of that, but in this type of class that is a general survey of industrial hygiene, I don't think it's appropriate to to burden you like that. So I'm going to do the reading for you. I've decided that you don't have to read chapter 10. It is an option if you want to learn more about it or if you want to review what I'm talking about in the lectures, but you're not required to read chapter 10. There's not a study guide. The unit quizzes will be based entirely on the material that I cover in the video lectures. It seemed like there was something else I was going to say. I can't think of it right at the moment. I'll think of it at some point during this lecture or another video lecture. Now, one thing... Oh, I remember what it was. Yeah, this is such a big chapter and a big unit, or a big topic. I could easily spend an entire class just covering occupational radiation, talking about ionizing and non-ionizing radiation. But like I said, for most safety professionals, it's not going to be that relevant. It's important for us to have some basic knowledge, but as far as day in and day out, need to use the information, it's probably not going to be the case unless you work in the medical field or a nuclear power plant, those types of facilities, or maybe an industrial facility that uses radiation for sterilization, or uses industrial X-ray equipment. That, you know, that's very limited as far as the workplaces where you're going to encounter ionizing radiation. And beyond background levels. Now, when I've covered this unit before in class, face-to-face, I bring in a lot of internet resources, a lot of internet links. To save time, I'm not going to click on all the video links and all of these different internet resources that you see before you. But what I've done, I've created a separate a PDF that will have all of these links available to you. If you want to learn more about banana dose and what we mean by banana dose, you can click on that link. If you want to take a closer look at OSHA's regulations with regard to ionizing radiation, there's a link for you. And if you want to learn more about the Broken Arrow landfill that's contaminated with radioactive waste, I've got a couple of links for that also. I am going to talk a little bit about all of this. But this, you can think of this as just more detailed information about the issue of occupational radiation, specifically, or mostly, I should say, ionizing radiation. All right, occupational exposure, as I've already alluded to, is relatively rare. There are industries where you may encounter occupational exposure to levels of ionizing radiation above background levels. The medical field is probably the leader of all economic sectors when it comes to the potential for radiation exposure. Mining, there's that potential. When you're working in the ground, there's potential that you could encounter radon or other radioactive materials during the mining process. Power generation, thinking mostly about nuclear power generation, there may be exposure. Construction and agriculture, also because you're working with the land. We're going to talk about radon. The greatest exposure Americans have to ionizing radiation is radon gas. And I'll talk more about that in more detail. But if radon comes out of the ground, it's a product of uranium decay. As uranium-238 decays, goes through what we call the decay chain, which I'll show you here in just a second, radon-222 is produced. And radon-222 accounts for about two-thirds of our exposure in the United States to ionizing radiation. And because it's coming out of the ground, you're working in the ground, just like with mining, construction, and agriculture, there may be higher levels of exposure. And some industries, like I said before, they may use ionizing radiation for sterilization, to sterilize equipment, sterilize materials, sterilize foods, to kill microorganisms. Also, X-rays are used outside the medical field in some industries for inspection, testing, quality control purposes, so there may be some exposure there. But overall, exposure is relatively rare in the workplace. I mentioned the medical field. That's where we're most likely to see exposure, I would argue. Let's say you're an X-ray tech working in the medical field. You know, an X-ray tech is going to be right on the front lines for radiation exposure. But even someone with that level of exposure, I would argue that their greatest risk to their health, to their life every day, is driving to work. It's not radiation. It's other risks, other dangers in their lives are actually greater than exposure to radiation. Again, this assumes, of course, that the X-ray tech is protected by shielding and some other measures that are taken, that should be taken, that need to be taken to protect the X-ray tech from ionizing radiation. I mentioned background radiation. We're all exposed to sources of ionizing radiation every day. There's radiation bombarding us from space. Most of it bounces off the atmosphere. We're protected from that cosmic or space radiation from the magnetic barrier that surrounds the Earth. Most of it doesn't come through, but we do get a small dose every day from space. Homeowner radon exposure is probably the greatest source of background radiation. If you live in an area where radon is common, you need to have a radon test for your home. Again, like I said before, 2/3 of U.S. exposure is from radon. Also, our food can be radioactive. An example of that would be bananas that contain an unstable isotope of potassium, potassium-40. And when we're talking about radioactive elements, we're talking about unstable isotopes of those elements. Potassium-40 is an unstable isotope. You eat a banana, you're getting a really, really small amount, a harmless amount of ionizing radiation. Now, one of the videos in the index that you might want to take a look at, it's only about 3 minutes long, but it looks at the biological effects of ionizing radiation. This video is from the Centers for Disease Control. I will be sharing with you biological effects, health hazards of ionizing radiation exposure as we go along. But if you'd like to look at the video, it's in that index, in that PDF that I'm providing to you on Blackboard. Now, let's say you do end up working in a radioactive environment. Again, it's probably most of you who graduate are not going to end up working in a nuclear power plant. Some of you might end up working in a medical environment, a medical field. We do have safety professionals or graduates occasionally that end up working as safety environmental professionals for the healthcare industry. But if you end up working in a radioactive environment, wherever that might be, and additional study would be needed, and you would receive that from your employer. They would cover the cost of you receiving additional training when it comes to working in that radioactive environment. And again, we're talking about a workplace with potential for radiation exposure. But one thing to keep in mind, whether it's radiation or whether it's other chemicals, the same management principles apply. We're evaluating, we're conducting hazard analyses, we're conducting training with the workers who are exposed, and we're implementing controls. engineering controls, administrative controls, PPE controls. You know, PPE, it's the lowest level of control, but when you're talking about a radioactive environment, it's important. And we'll take a look at some of the different personal protective equipment that's available to workers in these radioactive environments. Let's talk about some radiation basics, and we're talking about what I'll call elemental radiation, radioactive elements, radiation from naturally occurring elements. Now, radiation can be created by machines. There's other sources of radiation. But what I'm talking about here with this these radiation basics are those naturally occurring, or they could be, it could be man-made manipulated elements from the periodic table. Again, atoms are the basic building blocks of nature. Everything around us consists of atoms. It has an atomic structure made up of protons, neutrons, and electrons. And we see that basic structure illustrated over here on the right. This structure includes a nucleus made up of positively charged protons and neutrons that do not carry a charge. Think of them as neutral, neutron. They don't carry a charge. Protons, positively charged. Neutrons, no charge. Electrons orbit around the nucleus, and they have a negative electrical charge. Atoms, I don't want to say necessarily that they're electrically balanced, because there can be imbalances that occur. There can be instabilities that occur, and that's when we get into radiation energy, when those instabilities occur. And but at the atomic level, elements are always working toward a stable form. An unstable element goes through what we call a decay process. It decays to the point where it becomes a stable element. And I'm getting a little ahead of myself now, but let's go ahead. Basic atomic structure we have here. We have the nucleus made up of protons, neutrons, surrounded by orbitals of electrons. And they are electrically neutral structures. But we do have isotopes that occur. An isotope is a variation of an element's atomic structure. Now, the proton count for an atom is always the same for each isotope. But neutron count is different. So let's say you have multiple isotopes of one element, and you can have. I'll show you here in just a second. We'll use carbon as an example. So you have multiple isotopes of carbon. I'll go ahead and jump into that example here. And there are 15 different carbon isotopes, C8 through C22. They all have the same number of protons, but the neutron count is different. Neutron count is different. Carbon-12 has 6 protons and 6 neutrons. Carbon-13 has 6 protons and 7 neutrons. And we could go on with some other examples as well. There are over 300 naturally occurring isotopes. We take our periodic table. From that periodic table, there are 300 naturally occurring isotopes of the different elements. And there are many more synthetic isotopes, meaning isotopes that have been created in a laboratory. Most of these isotopes are what we call stable. In C12, C13, they're stable. But there are isotopes of carbon that are unstable. And we'll get more into instability on the next slide and how that is relevant to the study of radiation. Over here on the right, we have some examples of different nomenclature that you might run into when you take certification exams or when you're reading technical documents. So just to make you familiar with this, with the different nomenclature you might run into, I wanted to throw some of it at you. Again, atomic number is the number of protons. This is the symbol for radon. The atomic number for radon is 86, indicating that it has 86 protons. The atomic mass that we have here whoops, got ahead of myself, the atomic mass that we have here on the lower left, this is the number of protons plus the number of neutrons. These are some other variations on how this information may be presented. You may see it in technical publications or other locations or certification exams. Again, same information is just laid out differently. In this variation here, they have the atomic number on top, the atomic mass on the bottom, and it's just reversed here. You see it all three ways as far as the way this information is presented. Again, you will also see radon referred to as radon-222, RN-222, and then radon-222. And I'm using radon specifically as an example because it is the most common element as far as producing ionizing radiation that we're exposed to in the U.S. And there are a lot of different isotopes. Every element has multiple isotopes. An unstable isotope is an isotope that's undergoing what we call nuclear decay. As it decays, it's releasing energy as it progresses toward stability. It's releasing energy as it progresses toward a stable state of its existence, stable state of matter. As it's releasing energy, if it's an unstable isotope decaying and releasing energy, it is considered radioactive. It's a radioactive element. Again, radiation is the energy released during nuclear decay. Radioisotope is the term for an unstable isotope undergoing nuclear decay and releasing energy. And here are some of the more problematic, common, unstable radioactive isotopes. And notice we have carbon-14. We talked a little bit as an example of carbon-12, carbon-13. They were stable. Carbon-14 is not. It is going through this decay process, which we'll look at on the next slide. Uranium-238, radium-226, radon-222, and so on. All elements have at least one unstable radioactive isotope, naturally occurring or synthetic. Again, they can be created in a laboratory. The elements that we have here marked with a red X, and there are several here, these are elements that do not have any known stable isotopes. There are no known stable isotopes for the elements marked with an X, indicating they're all radioactive elements. Some of them are very rare, some of them are more common, but they have no stable isotopes. They are radioactive elements. Now the other elements in the periodic table here, they're going to have stable and unstable. Even, you know, helium, there's an unstable isotope of helium. Now the decay chain, the half-life, is in fractions of a second. Getting a little ahead of myself there. So it's not as much of a concern. And many of these are not really a great concern when we're talking about ionizing radiation. But all of these elements have unstable radioactive isotope forms. Talk a little bit about the decay chain, nuclear decay. Again, unstable isotopes are going through a series of decays before they reach a stable form. This is an abbreviated example of the uranium-238 decay chain. And you notice, and you might find this surprising and interesting, uranium-238, when it reaches its final form, it's not uranium anymore. It's lead, lead-206, which is stable. But to get from uranium-238 to lead-206 is a lengthy process. We go from uranium-238 to thorium-234. And as that decay occurs, it's producing alpha particles, which we haven't talked about the different forms of radiation yet, but one form is alpha particles. Then we have from thorium-234, it's decaying to protactinium-234. Protactinium-234. And as it goes from thorium-234 to protactinium-234, it's releasing beta particles. And then it goes from there to uranium-234 and thorium-230 and radium-226, radon-222. Radon gas, that is the most common source of ionizing radiation, is a result of the uranium-238 decay chain. If as the decay process continues, it goes to polonium, lead-214, which is still unstable. It's an unstable isotope of lead. Then we have bismuth-214. We have polonium-214. Polonium again. Whoops, sorry about that. Didn't mean to do that yet. Let's see. And to make a long story short, uranium-238 will eventually become stable lead-206, and that's where we got it here. And along the way, it's releasing energy as alpha particles or beta particles. And we'll talk more about the different forms of radiation in another video. As we talk about nuclear decay, we need to talk about the concept of half-life. Half-life, there are different variations of the half-life concept. For our purposes, let's just think of half-life as the time required for a radioisotope to lose half its energy. In one half-life period, a radioisotope will lose one half of its nuclei, or one half of its energy. For helium-6, helium-6 is one of those unstable isotopes of helium. The half-life is less than 1 second. It's 8/10 of a second for helium-6 to lose half of its energy. So it's pretty much all of its energy is lost within a couple of seconds. Uranium-238, on the other hand, 4.46 billion years is the half-life for uranium-238. Now, what I'm showing you here, you don't have to do this in our class, but these are some formulas that you might see on certification exams. These are formulas that can be used to calculate different values related to the concept of half-life. I do have a separate video on that covers radiation calculations. You're not required to watch that video for this class. There's not going to be any practice problems for the radiation calculations, but if you do want to take a look at it, if you're thinking ahead about CSP down the road, you can go ahead and take a look at that video. Ionizing radiation. Let's talk about ionizing radiation. We're getting close to going ahead and putting an end to this first video. Ionizing radiation, I've used the term several times, is radiation that produces enough energy to ionize other atoms. Ionization, as the radiation is absorbed by or passes through other materials, like our bodies, it alters the atomic structure. As radiation is absorbed into our bodies and passes through our bodies, it changes our atomic structure. It strips electrons. Remember, we have protons and neutrons in the nucleus and electrons on the outside at the atomic level. Well, as this energy is absorbed into our bodies at the atomic level, we're being torn apart, and hence the damage that's done to our body, the effects that it can have. And that's in a very simple nutshell, ionizing radiation. Non-ionizing radiation also is a concern, but maybe not as great of a concern for safety managers. This is a form of radiation that doesn't produce ions, that doesn't strip electrons. Non-ionizing radiation sources that we might encounter in the workplace would be magnetic fields, radio waves, microwave radiation, lasers, and the big I think the most harmful, most important thing for safety managers to pay attention to when it comes to any form of radiation is the ultraviolet radiation from the sun. Ultraviolet radiation from the sun can result in cataracts, can result in other eye disorders, variety of skin disorders, including serious forms of skin cancer, can result from ultraviolet radiation from the sun, which is a form of non-ionizing radiation. Non-ionizing radiation does produce heat, and it can produce a great deal of heat. And that's the source of harm associated with non-ionizing radiation, is the heat. And it doesn't affect the electron structure at the atomic level. Excuse me. To measure, or the measurement unit used to measure radiation energy is a unit we call the electron volt. Yeah, electron volt is a is the measurement unit for ionization energy of a radioisotope. Electron volt's the basic unit. We also will run into kilo electron volts, which 1 kilo electron volt is 1,000 electron volts. Then mega electron volt, you'll see that a lot in different materials. That is 1 million electron volts. But that's just, I throw this in here because you're going to run into this, that concept, I think, on certification exams. All right, I'm going to go ahead and end this here. We're like 32 minutes into this first video. It's a good time to start. When we come back, we'll talk more about sources of radiation.